A voice for the voiceless. That's how some describe the Urban League of Rochester. The local arm of the nationally renowned organization launched at a time of racial and economic unrest in our community. And it's been serving the underserved for the past 50 years. Its focus is helping African Americans, Latinos, and the disadvantaged become economically self-sufficient through jobs, education, home ownership, and entrepreneurship. To learn more about this organization's wide reach, I'm joined by Urban League of Rochester President William Clark, former president of the Urban League, whose 21-year tenure began in 1972, former Mayor Bill Johnson, and an alum of the Urban League's Black Scholars Program, attorney Taryn Greenwich. It's a pleasure to have all of you joining me. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we've got the After School Academy, the Black Scholars Program, Paths to Recovery, in-home services for the elderly, and these are just a handful of the 30 or so programs that the Urban League is operating. And all that being said, I am certain that there are people watching right now and they're thinking, I had no idea the Urban League was involved in so many different things. And you told me this before, William, you said that you don't seek attention for the work of the Urban League. Why not?
One of the things that we do at the Urban League is we make sure that we're providing services that eliminate disparities in the community. Every year, our national office comes out with a book on the state of Black America, and it shows the progress that African Americans, Latinos, and other minorities have made as it relates to parity. And so our programs are designed to bring that parity into the Rochester community. While I don't personally seek recognition for our programs, one of the things that we do is we want to make sure that the community is aware that these programs exist and these programs are there for the benefit of the entire community.
Well, Bill, you're credited for taking the reins in the early 70s as president and making the Urban League A, financially stable, and B, for really extending its wide reach within the community. And given your rich history in Rochester, I'm curious to know, looking back on the past several decades, is there something that you can point to and you can say, you know what, had it not been for the Urban League launching in Rochester, we wouldn't have this today, or we would not have made progress in terms of this today?
Well, I certainly can look back on a wide array of programs, and it certainly feels good that a lot of them still exist today, which proves that, you know, that they are meeting an ongoing need. But I think that the finest example of our work will be reflected in a young lady that you're going to talk to here in a minute, in the Black Scholars Program, because when that initially started, it was primarily to just recognize and give value to academic achievement. We just felt that there weren't enough opportunities in the mainstream for young Black students to really get recognized for what they do. But that program has evolved into something far greater. It has empowered these young people to go forward, to gain a good education, and to gain marketable skills, and to bring those skills back home. I mean, it has been phenomenal to me, the number of people that I have met who remind me that they were either Black scholar during my tenure or in succeeding years, and that they are now in Rochester working, leading, and setting an example for even younger people. So this is a program that can last for many, many more decades because it is premised on a very simple point. You know, you do well, you reach back and bring someone else along. And I've said facetiously that, you know, what I want on my tombstone is he founded the Black Scholars Program. That's all I to me, that's just the capstone of my career, yeah.
So just in terms of, before we go to you, Taryn, the Black Scholars Program, as you said, it celebrates the achievements of African-American high school students who maintain at least a B average. The program has an endowment fund. It also has an early recognition program, and this is to encourage young students to maintain a high GPA. It reaches about 1,500 students each year, and I've read that more than 10,000 kids have graduated graduated through the Black Scholars Program since it launched in 1980. And Taryn, you're one of them. Yes. And your story, though, it doesn't stop there, because you got your law degree, you returned to Rochester, and you became heavily involved with the Urban League. You started its Young Black Professionals Group. And so I want to know, what type of influence has the Urban League had on you personally, and what type of impact do you think it's had on your life and in terms of your career choices and also your outreach work?
Yeah, I think the Urban League provides, you know, as Bill stated, with the Black Scholars Program, such a great opportunity for you to see other people who look like you who are also excelling and who are focused and dedicated. And so it provides a networking opportunity in and of itself. I keep in touch with a lot of fellow Black Scholars alumni who participated in the program when I did. So when I came back, it was easy to kind of reconnect with the Urban League, having some familiarity with the programs and initiatives that they offer, and wanting to find a way for myself and other similarly situated young professionals who've returned to really give back to the community and to really make a difference to an organization that even in high school assisted us or made a difference for us as well.
And obviously, I mean, this is, Rochester is desperate for more programs like this, but it seems, yes, like kids don't always live up to the challenge. So is there a plan or an effort to engage more students or to expand the reach of the program?
The reason we started the early recognition program was so that we could expand the reach. It's a feeder, and it provides the parents and the students with opportunities. They know that if their children excel in 9th, 10th, and 11th grade, that they can receive scholarships, they can receive grants, that there are colleges that are actively recruiting them. So once that program began, we saw the number of Black scholars increase exponentially. So it's a tremendous feeder for the program. Mm-hmm. And we understand that everyone is not going to be a Black scholar. So we have programs like the Youth Build program, where we teach the construction trades, where we work with the community college and the school district to make sure that the young people get their high school equivalency, that they learn the trade, that they walk away with industry recognized credentials through the college if they decide they want to take the technical and the skilled trades route. So what we try to do is provide opportunities for gainful employment or career advancement for all young people.
And I'll tell you this quick story. Many years ago, I met a young woman from Rochester who was the director of the Albany Urban League. And I'd never known her. And as we were talking, she said, you know, my greatest disappointment was my high school, when I graduated in the early 1980s, they did not recognize the Black Scholars Program, so they did not submit my name. And she said, I was almost an A student. And so we invited her to come and speak, and we went back and checked her records. And sure enough, she had a superior record, but this suburban school just didn't feel it was valuable. So we actually bestowed the Black Scholar Award on her after the fact. She was so proud. I just had dinner with her in Philadelphia about a month ago. She's now a top administrator at Temple University. She has a PhD. She's earned a PhD. And I tell that story because, I mean, she was well on her way. She'd already achieved a great success in her career. But she felt that she was missing something that she should have gotten. So I just think that it's so inspirational to see people like Taryn who, and there's many more Terrans in this community who have come back, and who in other communities. Young man Michael Robinson, who has great success on Wall Street, left this program, went to Florida A&M. We could just tell you many, many stories of young people that, just like that, who are just doing spectacular things.
When it comes to the future of the Urban League, and I know the mission has stayed the same, but in terms of readjusting, you know, the focus obviously would need to readjust with the changing, yes, of the times, and as our society changes and our varied cultures, is tapping the knowledge of Taryn and others who have been a part of the Black Scholars Program and a part of the programs within the Urban League. Is that a priority kind of in determining the future of the program and where you decide to go?
It's absolutely a top priority. About 10 years ago, we took a look at our board of directors, and we realized we didn't have anyone on our board that was under the age of 30. So we did an aggressive effort, and now over 10% of our board, they're under 30. So we bring young people in because we know that, as you indicate, times change, ideas change, strategies change. So we want the young people in the boardroom at the decision-making level to make sure that we are in contact with young folks, with their visions, their ideas. And Taryn is one of our board members, and I think she could speak to that also.
Well, we're out of time, but I thank you for being here. And Taryn Greenidge, Bill Johnson, and William Clark, thank you for your time. And congratulations for the 50th anniversary of your work in Rochester. And you can learn more about the Urban League and its varied programs. Check out the website, ulr.org.